Let's turn to John chapter 11. We shall begin to go back into the following of the Lamb whithersoever he goeth in his earthly ministry. And we want to look at our groaning God. Our groaning God. That comes from John 11:33. We'll begin reading with verse number 1 of John chapter 11. This is one of the last things that the Lord Jesus is going to do publicly before he enters into Jerusalem for the last time. And this is a very notable thing that happens. And it is a unique passing of events that set in motion that which cannot be changed. These events in this chapter are going to establish him in his glorious life eternally and in his death naturally. And these things are going to be locked in and cannot be altered. John chapter 11, verse 1. Now a certain man was sick, named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sisters sent unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. When Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Don't make any mistake about it. Now, Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. You need to understand that. That's not little syrupy emotion. That's God, who is love, loving them in purity of spirit and heart. When he had heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was. Verse 32. Then when Mary was come where Jesus was and saw him, it's good to come where Jesus is. And if you truly see him, you will do what she did. She fell down at his feet, saying unto him, probably that which she had talked about with her sister Martha, and had probably said these same words to one another in private, Lord, if thou hast been here, my brother had not died. The groaning that we're going to hear from the Savior is going to pertain to that. They would have been satisfied for him to heal the sick. The glory of God would have been seen if he had healed the sick. But this sickness was not unto death, but he died. Yes, but the sickness was not unto death, but he died. I understand that, but this sickness is not unto death. Sometimes we limit the Lord by our petition. Sometimes we limit God by our lack of, can I say, thinking outside the box. Sometimes we contain God within our own human emotions and understanding of God, and we need to leave our self-made consciousnesses of God at home and come and worship the revelation of God by the Holy Ghost. If thou hast been here, my brother had not died. That's not what the glory of God in this case is about. He's got to get to the cross. The brother has got to die, and the brother has got to be made alive by the person of the resurrection, and the Jews have got to, on this very day, this is the day they're going to determine, we can't put up with this anymore. It is expedient that one man die for our nation. We've got to kill him. So in doing what he did, he brought Lazarus to life, and he brought himself to death. There's more here than meets the eye, and that's why we don't understand verse 33, that God can groan. A groan is the sound of a felt inability to express the deepest emotion of pain, heartache, discouragement. It's all you can do. It's an expression of the inability to verbalize the inward depth of pain. The Holy Spirit deals in this, and we'll see in Romans 8:26, that he listens out for groans and intercedes for us himself with groans which cannot be uttered. A groan is an unutterable sound to express the inability of that which cannot be uttered. Does that make any sense? If thou had been here, my brother had not died. That is little faith. It's not bad faith. It's not bad that she said that. Nobody's condemning her. But that's not what God has in mind for that day. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping, which came with her, he groaned in the spirit. And would you allow me to tell you what these last words really say? He groaned where? In the spirit, and troubled himself. You would do well to draw one line through the word was in your King James, and behind the word troubled, write himself. Jesus Christ was made of a woman, made under the law. He was very God and very man. He is the middle between God and man, the man, the mediator, Christ Jesus. As God, he is above all inordinate affection. God has wrath, God has hatred, God has jealousy, but none of them are sinful. But as the God-man, he was made like unto his brothers. And he is going to be, for your salvation, in all points, tempted like, you getting this? He's going to be, for your salvation, in all points tempted, just like we are. But he can't have an ounce of self-motivation in it. What did he just say? Calm down. It's all right. This is for the glory of God. Did not I say unto you at the beginning that this was for that thou should see the glory? Verse 40. If thou wouldest believe, thou should see the glory of who? God. It would have been glorious unto man if it was not Jesus Christ doing it. If somebody had the ability to raise a man from the dead, and one of the Old Testament prophets, they threw his body in the grave, and whoever's in there with him got up and walked off. It would have been the glory of man. It would have been the glory of that prophet. But this is not that level. You're going to have to come with me. Rise up, O men of God. You're going to have to mount up with wings as eat with eagles if you're going to get this message today. It's way beyond anything that I could ever reach even with all of the experience and with all of the leadership of the Spirit upon this mortality that I could ever reach, you're going to have to leave your prejudices. You're going to have to leave your concepts of religion. You're going to have to leave your practice of theological tradition and come into the realm of almost the mystical, but yes, the spiritual. If thou hast been here, you stay right there, you're not going to get it. Prevention this time is not what he's all about. If thou hast been here, my brother would not have died. If you were here before he died, you could have prevented this. I didn't intend to prevent this. Tell the man that asked, why is this happening to us? Ask him, why should it not happen to you? Do you not want to rise above the experiences of mortal flesh? Should we not stand beside small caskets where the little soul didn't get to breathe, you know, but a few days of earth's air? Should not we stand beside doctors and nurses in intensive care rooms and watch our loved ones struggle? Who are we that we should not suffer? The only one that should never have suffered is the one that suffered the most, Jesus Christ. But our suffering is not for punishment. Our suffering is an invitation to come up with me. Fellowship is what he calls it. That I may know him. How? In the what? Agony of his suffering. No, in the fellowship. Boy, Baptists love that word. We're going to have fellowship. You know what that means? Cake and coffee. God used that word. That I may know him. How are you going to know him? I must needs go home by one way. Do you know what that is? The way of the cross. If you never get sight of the gates of light, what's the one thing you know you missed? The way of the cross. God had one son without sin. He does not have any sons without a cross. Your master, your Lord, your Savior is on the other side of a cross. You're going to have to go through it to get there. Prevention, yes, could have been, but it was not to be. This is a matter of, quote, the glory of not Lazarus, not Martha, not Mary, but of God. You're going to have to leave your natural lodestone of practice of religion. Drop those things and rise into the spiritual realm. And for one time, think only about God, not you, not me, not them, not whatever's going on at the hospital, not whatever's on the prayer list. Right now, you're going to have to think about God alone. Or else you're not going to be able to understand how our God groaned. If he groans out of inordinate affection, we're all going to hell. Colossians 3:5. Colossians 3:5. Do you think that God would give a command that he himself would not obey? I know you're looking at your Bibles trying to find Colossians 3. We're going to begin with verse 4. But let me ask you something. Do you think God would give a command that he himself would not obey? Do you know what bought you your salvation? The obedience of Jesus Christ to his Father. That's it. He did what his Father said to do. Obedience. Now, Colossians 3:4. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in what kind of state? In a glorified state, right? Now, what's the second word of verse 5? Or what's it there for? It's there to tell you, you ain't going in that glorified state unless this right here takes place. The first word is what? What does that have to do with? Death, a mortician. Make dead, therefore, your members. It's not talking about your arms and your legs and your fingers and your toes. It's talking about these things. Mortify, therefore, your members which are upon the earth. You need to take that and cross-reference it with Revelation chapter 12 and know the difference between, in Revelation 12:12, woe unto them who are on the earth and those who are in heaven. It's not talking about physically in heaven. It's talking about spiritually and or have risen up above all these fleshly things. All right. Mortify, therefore, your members which are earthy. That's what he's talking about. Fornication, uncleanness. What's the next one? Did it say affection? Just plain out uncleanness and then affection. No. What kind of affection does it say? Inordinate or improper or that which goes beyond the bounds. Have you ever seen a newsreel? Well, you ever seen the news where somebody died over in the East and women are hollering and screaming and crying and throwing themselves on the casket and people are beating themselves in the face with sticks and everything till they're bloody and they're hollering and crying and you think, what in the world happened? It must be something horrible. That's inordinate affection. Weep, yes, but not as those who have no hope. Those people are weeping without hope. That's what it looks like. God says we are to make dead our affection that's out of bounds, that's out of limit. Evil concupiscence, lust, covetousness, idolatry. Listen to verse 6 now. For which things sake the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience. If you are involved in these and you are not working and cooperating with the Holy Spirit to bring these things into your life as a living reality, then the wrath of God is going to have to be tasted. And you're going to miss, in verse 4, the appearance with him in glory. These are things which take place and transpire in the life of the believer. God's going to clean that thing up. You and God and the Holy Ghost are going to have to present yourself back to God in a better state than you were in when he presented himself to you in your regeneration. Listen at the next verse. In the which, ye also walked sometime when ye lived in them. These are the things that we should be battling, not the things that the whore church has got written on their placards as they march on Washington. These are the things that you should be dealing with every single day of your life. Cooperating with the Holy Spirit to make dead, to mortify, that's part of sanctification, to kill out, to destroy the energies of the flesh, and to vivify, to make alive, and to enhance and edify the things of the Holy Spirit. Because you, as he said in verse 4, have been promised that the appearance of Christ will transport you into a glorified state. Anybody disagree with that? So we go back to John chapter 11. And we read verse 33. And most commentators and most religiously minded students of the Bible will say, here is the cause for Jesus groaning. Merely that he saw her weeping and the Jews also weeping. That's what it says. That's all there is to it. But when you read the rest of the verse, you can't hold that exclusively to just him weeping with those that weep. Because it does say in another passage, let those that weep be as those that weep not. 1 Corinthians 7 and verse 30. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and troubled himself. As I have journeyed with the Lord, I have found out something about myself and about human emotion. There are times when we can be mad because we just want to be mad. We're tired of everybody dumping on us, and whoever's the first one that walks around the corner next, they're going to get it. But then if we could be mad because we wanted to be mad, then we could hold back that anger with a disciplined spirit and mind, calling on the Holy Ghost to help us. The Bible said, and you can look it up, look it up in any translation, he troubled himself. Mortify therefore your members. What is understood? You. We are to mortify. Does that mean God won't do it for you? It means God will do it with you.
Yeah. Amen.
Hello.
That's right.
Do you hear that? Listen, it's something you got to do. It's something I got to do. You can give yourself the permission to be mean, and you will be mean. You can give yourself the permission to be impatient, and you will be. You will be able to give yourself permission to draw a line in the sand and say, I've had enough. But then you can also call upon the Holy Spirit to do that which you can't do and be honest, that which we don't want to do. This is my time to be angry and I'm going to have it. But Jesus can't do that. He cannot have an inordinate affection. This affection that he has, it says, when he saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping, which came with her. Now, it doesn't say he wept. It does in verse 35, but not right here. It says he groaned. That had to be a spiritual, God the Father accepted, felt inability to express the deepest emotion, which we're going to find out was a lightning flash prayer that the Holy Spirit brought before God with that groaning which could not be uttered. For let me ask you something. What is the last phrase in verse 41? Start with Father. Try it again, everybody do it. Father. Tell me when he prayed. Find it in John 11. There ain't no mention of Christ praying at all. But there is a mention of his groaning. We will read it later. You want to read it now? We can. Romans 8:26, with groanings which cannot be uttered, maketh intercession for you. The Holy Spirit maketh intercession with you, for you, with groanings which cannot be uttered. So this groan was a prayer of unutterable human expression. He had to express humankind in its perfection unto God, and it had to be pure and harmless and holy and undefiled and separate from sinners. God is going to groan. God is going to groan not only for man, but as man and on behalf of their salvation. This is going to be that which the high priest looks at as the sinner, the leper, whoever he is, brings the lamb before the altar and presents the innocent victim for his sin. The lamb is going to be examined carefully and cautiously. His eyes, his ears, his feet, his body, his nose, everything about him is going to be examined, and it has to be perfect. God the Father is hearing this prayer. You read me in verse 41, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. Now read me the first phrase in verse 42.
And I knew that thou hearest me always.
And the only reason I'm saying it out, the rest of that verse, is so that the people can know that I'm talking to you. This groan cannot be inordinate affection. This groan is going to have to be an expression from the God-man to the purity of God the Father, that it may properly represent the holiness of God the Father, but it may represent the God-man who is the head over all the church. He's going to have to express grief in a holy and a perfect way on behalf of those who can hear the groan. That's God the Father, God the Holy Ghost, and all the people that stood around him. He groaned in the spirit and troubled himself. And he said, where have ye laid him? He knew where he was. He knew exactly what he was going to do. He told him from the beginning, this sickness is not unto death. But he died. But this sickness is not unto death. He won't be dead tonight. He'll sleep in his own bed. He will eat supper at the supper table with the rest of you. He knew where he laid, where they was laid. But he's going to have to act out. Verse 34 is just as important as verse 33. He's going to have to hold back himself and his omniscience to be able to act out his part in faith before God. Jesus Christ is the author of faith. How did he author faith? By having faith in God. He established it when he said, thou wilt not leave my soul in hell or allow thine Holy One to see corruption. Psalm 16 and verse 10. So he had faith in God, and he, like Adam, before Adam sinned, he came and stood before God Almighty on his own merit. The first human being ever since the fall of man in the garden to come and stand before God on his own merit stands here by faith. He has to have the reality of humanity. So he says, where have you laid him? Denying his omniscience. Listen, if he knew that the man wasn't going to be dead when the day was over with, and he knew that it was for the glory of God, he knew where he was. And they said unto him, Lord, come and see. We have gone from, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died, human consciousness to prevent is what we want God to do, to now leading him to where death in a reality now has overcome this man's life. And they said unto him, Lord, come and see. Now the groans in verse 33 become tears in verse 35. Jesus wept. Again, humanity interprets God wrongfully. And then said the Jews, behold how he loved him. You don't know how much he loved him, sir, not until you see him and Jesus sit down to supper together. You don't know how much he loved him yet, sir. Oh, if I had been in the garden and I had had a hoe, I'd have chopped that snake's head off, and this all would have been prevented. If you'd only come, Holy Savior, light of the world, light of life, and dealt with Satan, then none of us would be dead in trespasses and sins. But he waited until we were. Because he did not want you not to allow him to have the experience of entering into your life with you, born of a woman, born under the law, for what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own son, watch it now, in the likeness of sinful flesh. You explain that to me. It would not have been possible for God and man to come together in the glory that it speaks of in Colossians 3:4. Unless there was a common denominator, so that the bottom rail on the ladder, the bottom rung on the ladder were low enough, God had to descend that far. And that's as far up as man could be, a dead sinner, without God and without hope in this world. No ability to have fellowship with God. God had to bring this thing down to death. We have fantasies. The devil gives them to us. He's the angel of light. He's in charge of more religion than Jesus is in this nation. I don't back up on that statement. Throw rocks at me if you will. That's the truth. And fanciful religious imagination. If thou had been here, we would not have had to fall in the garden. You want prevention. God's not after prevention. He's after glory. Not only his glory, but your glory. You don't know what you're asking for. You'd be content to live on that low level of having no problems. God said, no, I'm going to load you up with problems so that you can enter into the fellowship with me personally of my individual personal sufferings for your sin. We're going up, children. We're going up. You can stay down if you want to. You can transverse if you want down to the subway under the ground. But listen, you can rise up with wings as eagles, and for one time, without selfish motives in your mind, I'm going to say a word, let God be all important and supreme. We got so many arguments as to why we don't want to be glorified.
I don't like the way he preaches. I don't like the way he combs his hair. You know, I don't like this. I don't like what she said. I don't, you know, I think we ought to do this. We got so much burden of self-centeredness, and we will not trouble ourselves to be without inordinate affection. We got to have, oh, you just don't know what they did to me.
You'll never reach God like that. The reason our passions are sinful are for two reasons. Number one, they're not regulated by modesty. I have every right to hate with all the fire I can hate. I have all the right to slander with all the fire I can slander with. We're not regulated by modesty. Number two, because they don't arise from a lawful cause or produce a lawful end. Jesus had to have lawful groaning and emotions and affections and passions, or you could not be saved today. Jesus Christ had to regulate his affection, not inordinately because Martha was weeping. Yes, because Martha was weeping, and it put on him a sense of the responsibility of his headship over her, that she's not going to be able to see what he's come there to do until he does it, and she's not going to be able to understand her weeping unless he moderates it with the Spirit and the glory of God. He troubled himself. Behold how he loved them. Verse 37. And some of them said, could not, coulda, shoulda, woulda, could not this man, which opened the eyes of the blind, have caused that even this man, listen, should not have died. Could not, should not. Here we go again. This man has opened the eyes of the blind. Look at chapter 9, verse 32. Chapter 9 and verse 32. Open book test. How long has it been that it was not heard that any man could open the eyes of one that was born blind?
Since the world began.
Wait a minute. You mean the Chinese over yonder in Asia at the same time Jesus was being born over here? Those guys over there sent the wise men over here, look, with all their knowledge of, what's them needles they stick in people over there, you know, make them feel well?
Acupuncture.
And with all their herbs and with all their understanding, they never heard of anybody being healed that was born blind? No. This man could heal a man born blind. He didn't have the organs to be able to see. It didn't come with the kit. Have you ever bought anything and you started putting it together and find out you're missing something? Well, this guy was missing something. But God said, I'm the one that shaped the mud to start with to make this dude, this dude's grandfather. I'll just make some more tui. You know what tui is, don't you? And spit on the ground, made mud, turned that mud into eyeballs, put them in his head and said, okay, go wash. Could not this man. Could not this man. Is it not possible that this man should not have died? Prevention. Before the Lord Jesus comes back to get his church, we are going to quit trying to limit God by trying to prevent problems and learn to live in them to see the glory of God. All of us ain't going to make it. Some of us are doing everything we can right now to eliminate ourselves. We will not think beyond our own selfish emotions. You're going to have to leave behind everything that, you know, all that baggage you carry and what they did to me. And you're going to have to come to God. Oh, my soul, could not this man which opened the eyes of the blind have caused that even this man should not have died? Now look at verse 38. If you tell me that Jesus is groaning in verse 33 was because Martha was weeping, then I'll have to tell you, then you have to hold to that and say that Jesus is groaning in verse 38 again was because of the statement in verse 37, and he can't be motivated by human affection and emotions. This was almost a blaming him. Could not this man have fixed it so this man should not have been born blind? And listen what it says in verse 38. And therefore, Jesus, therefore, listen, again groaning. Where? In himself. He's got to get up higher than human affection. He's got to get beyond all of that which humanity gives a green light. It's my time to be mad, and I'm going to take it. My anger is going to go beyond all modesty. My jealousy is going to tear up this world. God is jealous, but he's not sinful. God hates, but it's not sinful. God has wrath, but it's not sinful. Have I ever had, I'm asking this about me. You want to answer it for me, you can. But how about you asking it about yourself? Have I ever had any emotions that were truly pure and holy before God? Jesus, therefore, again groaning in himself, cometh to the grave. It was a cave, and a stone lay upon it. Jesus said, take ye away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, is going to try to arrest his actions because she's thinking the only thing that could have been from Jesus, whom I believe to be the Son of God, and who will raise my brother according to a schedule at the last day. To her, the resurrection was a theological schedule and event. Jesus said, no, the resurrection is me. The only thing she can think of, wait a minute, he didn't get to come to the funeral home and join in us with the last viewing, whatever that is. So he just wants to roll the stone back and take another look at him. Or take a look at him for himself. So she tries to prevent him. Here is where the desire for him to prevent prevents him. Did you ever think that our limitations hinder our blessings? What would you have done when Jesus looked at that man, if you'd been that man, and he said, go thy way, be it unto thee according to thy faith? Would you have found your son made well when you got home? Well, I don't know. He didn't come. He didn't put no oil on his head. The prophet didn't come out and even see me. I ain't going to go dip myself in that old nasty river. Have you ever stopped to think that religion has trained us with such an encrusted attitude and with such an encrusted consciousness of God that we are hindering God from blessing us? Lord, by this time he stinketh, for he hath been dead 4 days. The Jews believe that the soul didn't leave the body till the fourth day. I don't know where they got it, but that's what they believed, and that's part of why he waited. It's not all of it, That's part of it. Jesus saith unto her. Now, is he going to address with theological debate what she just said? He stinketh. That's the truth. She said it right. Everything she says is correct, but it's the wrong thing to say. Are you sick that religion has trained you to be a parrot, Polly want a cracker? You know how to say everything in every situation, but you don't know that what you're saying is hindering the revelation of the glory of God above, beyond, outside of, wider, deeper, higher than anything you've ever experienced before? Are you content with your little Christianity binding you up? Are you content with just going through the practice of tradition? Or do you, in some wild world of mystic imagination, really want to walk with God? There ain't a person in here that couldn't pass the test on telling us about Enoch walking with God. But is there truly a person in here who actually does walk outside of traditional religious boundaries without the figment of religious imagination of God, but with the person of the deity himself? There's not a person in here that can't sing the words, probably most of us, on key. And he walks with me, and he talks with me. But does he? Have we not learned to be counterfeits in spiritual realms? Do we have the validity? Do we have the essence? Do we have the reality of God? If we preach this sermon, are we just trying to get to verse 35? Jesus wept. And just say, he cried too. You can. It's all right to be sad. Or did you get the message that he spoke in verse number 4? This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God. What will glorify God? That the Son of God may be glorified thereby. God is a figment of my imagination. That word God, thou thoughtest I was altogether such a one as thyself. In most Christianity in America, they sit on the throne of their own heart with the word God under it. That's what the Pharisee prayed. He prayed with himself, and he said, God, to himself. Listen, we need to understand that God, whoever, whatever you got in your head about that term, and it's a cold term, I prefer Father. It's a warm family term. But whatever that figment of imagination is, God cannot be glorified except Jesus Christ of Bethlehem, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, be glorified himself. Now you got the reality of the person of God, not just the figment of imagination of quote unquote God. Listen. Jesus, therefore, again groaning. He's groaning again. Martha says, by this time he stinketh. Jesus saith unto her, said I not unto thee that if thou wouldest believe, that if thou wouldest believe. You can quote me, you can finish the sentence, you can finish the verse. Every time I've asked it and left off a word, you've always supplied it correctly. The just shall live. See there, by faith, you get it right every time. But that's not the issue. Are we living by faith? The last almost 200 years in America, we have seen the death of the spiritual church. The last of the glorious evangelists that saw the mighty work of God, people weeping in churches over their sin, are dead and gone. And I feel like it was all over with before I ever got here. But what is my job? It is to bring us back, those who are of God's elect, those who have the Spirit of God, those who have faith, get you out of that. Come out of her, my people. May God get you to come, for it to come out of you, so that you can come out of her. Revelation 18:4. That you be not partaker of her sins and of her punishment. We need to come back to God. There needs to be an understanding that our God can groan, and it not be simply because Martha cried. Or Mary cried. We need to get back to the person of Christ. You've answered this question for me correctly every time I've ever said it. What is the original sin of man? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We have established that that's the issue. Here is the recovery of the glory. But dear soul, we have been so brainwashed and we have been so enamored with a crust of religion that we're just like little robots, wind them up, stick them up there, and watch them move. That we need to get back and recover ourselves from the organization of traditional religion to the organism of Jesus Christ. The Bible said we are to be made one spirit with Him. First of all, is there anybody here that wants to be? Is there anybody here that wants to be? Or can you not have patience enough to wait till this old coot gets through with his sermon so we can get right back into what we've always done? What if this were the last time that God was going to address your soul concerning this matter? Do you care? Would you turn with me to Isaiah 53? I want to leave this thought with you. In Isaiah 53, in verse number 11, He, that is the Lord of verse number 10, all capitals in the word Lord, God the Father, He shall see of the travail of His soul. Well, that's a lot right there. The essence of invisible glory, of invisible purity and holiness, is searching the heart of Jesus Christ. And what part of the heart is He looking at? He shall see the blank of His soul. The travail. I'm going to watch you, Jesus, and see if you're weeping because Mary wept out of inordinate affection. I'm the high priest. I'm searching this lamb for any blemish in it. Would it surprise you let me finish this. He shall see of the travail of his soul and shall be satisfied. Hold your place. Look at Lamentations. Can you find that? Jeremiah laments. So Lamentations comes right after the book of Jeremiah. Lamentations 3. And verse 36. Do you see those words in Isaiah 53:11? He shall see. Let me show you the exact same Hebrew word in Lamentations 3:36. I'll let you read it. To subvert a man in his cause, the Lord approveth and then not. The word approveth is the exact same Hebrew word he shall see in Isaiah 53:11. It is going to be Almighty God looking upon his soul to see whether God can stamp approved on this emotional expression. A groan, an inexpressible sound to try to convey the deepest emotion. Is it of God or is it not? You better know whether it is or not, because it depends on your salvation. God's going to look on his soul to see whether he approves that or not. Oh, my soul. We're going to finish with Isaiah 43 and verse number 25. God is looking at your heart. You have justification for being angry. You have justification for scoffing. You have justification for, I don't know why they do it, in your own mind and heart. But will God find that justification when he searches your heart? When he searches my heart? Listen, in Isaiah 43:25. I, even I, am he that blotteth out thy transgressions. Four words, please. I, even I, am he that blotteth out thy transgressions. Four words. God has to be perfect God and perfect substitute if he's going to blot out your transgressions, because he's going to do it based on his own character, actions, and his ability. I blot out your transgression for my sake. Isn't that something? And will not remember thy sins. Jesus Christ is going to have to groan in such a way that it's going to be a prayer going up, and he's going to be able to say, I thank thee, Father, that thou hast already heard me. The prayer would not have been heard had it been a sinful prayer. Lazarus would not have come out of the grave if it was a sinful groan. That was the only prayer you can find. Then if it was a self-centered, vainglorious thing, let's show them something, Lord. Let's tell them who I am. It wouldn't have worked. But the groan, like lightning, transmitted the Holy Spirit prayer, interceding for the humanity of Jesus of Nazareth into the presence of the Father. And evidently, it was a holy groan and a holy prayer, because the Bible said, he that was dead came forth.